Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, I'm John, this is Many a True Nerd, and welcome back to Rome Total War, our beautiful, beautiful empire. Oh, it's so big now. Look at this. Having taken the main cities of Thrace last time, leaving just a handful of Thracian troops, some just people standing around outside our city right there that we shall ride down next turn. Beautiful, and their one remaining little crappy city, the Thracian capital, is just some Dacian town there squatting in. Oh, it does not look good for the Thracians. Maybe we shall go and mop them up. But at this point, the episode where we mop up the Thracians, there probably won't even be a Thrace pun in the title because it's such an insignificant little event. I'm really looking beyond them. I'm looking to the Dacians. The Dacians, whose towns also look incredibly undefended. Hang on, who are Dace even actually allied or enemies with? Would that be a good idea? Allied with Britain. Right, I don't want to cause trouble with Britain. I want to keep Britain peaceful because, yeah, we can actually form me and Britain together. Even if they don't want to be allies, me and Britain together can just form this beautiful big line that stops the Julii advancing any further. So once they're done with Spain, they're kind of stuck. And that would work for me very well indeed. Anyway, this is the same turn we did a load of stuff last time, so I think there's nothing more I can do this turn. Bunch of new armies starting to come in to effect here. Little armies will just need to draw together and send over somewhere. Yes, and of course, and I can't forget, we have got ourselves that army ready to start heading south for the backstab against Egypt soon. But first, we need to see what the Egyptians are going to do next, because they have drawn together some decent-sized armies here. And the turn, Julii. Ooh, hello. Parthian Alliance. That actually might work as a useful little way of keeping the Armenians off our backs. Yeah, I'm actually going to accept that, I think. Lovely. Any chance you're willing to update our map information? And nope, sadly, we cannot equal it and must turn it down. That's a shame. Yeah, I'm happy to be allied with the Parthians. I have no real... Oh, good. And the Armenians are totally going to take on the Parthians, not me. So that's fine. Numidians want a ceasefire. That's okay. They can have one for now. They'd also like trade rights. Lovely. And they're probably not willing to update map information. Oh, no, they are. Marvellous. So if they had any new information, they are willing to share that. But it looks like they don't really know anything I didn't already. A couple of Thracians have gone after one of our ships. We should... How did you lose that? You were so experienced, damn it. Right, we need to just take out the last of the Thracian ships. Oh no! Aulus Augustus! Oh, our faction leader finally died. Where even was he then? Oh yeah, he was in Athens. He was in Athens. Oh, bless him. Aulus Augustus, who had a wonderfully long career, is actually dead. But unfortunately, that flipping means that this guy, Amulius the Wrathful, is the faction leader, which I'm not keen on, because... I just don't think he's a particularly nice guy. Oh no, he's even picked up favour of the gods. But you can just see, because of Bloodthirsty, he just can't actually lead our men into battle. So we should probably just stay in Byzantium, keeping it happy and keeping it prosperous, thanks to his decent management skills. Right, the big question is, that means we're going to have a new faction heir. Oh, blimey! Literally everyone is having children at once. Good, the game has detected our empire is big and it started just pouring out children for us. And Chickpea! My little Chickpea has picked up a priest of Mars, that's not that useful. But Periandros has picked up a physician, that is very useful indeed. He could just do with having more and more children. Periandros, you're the guy over in, yeah, you're in Patavium, aren't you? You're 53. I swear you already had a flipping physician, to be honest, but never mind. Also, you're 53. I need to get a kid over to you at some point to pass your retinue on to, because you're getting on. You've got a good retinue, even if you're not actually that good, to be honest. So I kind of need to get a new kid over to him. Right, who's the new faction heir, by the way? Because this now, of course, changes. So show the family tree. So, yeah, he's dead. You have become... Ooh, Spurius Scapula is actually the faction heir. So Aulus Augustus has died, and as a result, interesting, okay, because he didn't actually have son when the faction heir was actually set up, therefore faction heir was always on his brother, which has moved over to, but regardless, it's actually the eldest son, or rather not son, not natural born son anyway, married in son, it's the eldest son of Aulus Augustus has picked up faction heir. Now I'm fine with that, because his children, Manius Barbatus, Julianus Scapula, and Oppius Balbus, they are okay. I mean, Julianus Scapula is useless, but the other two who have married in are actually fine. The question is there someone I'd rather potentially be Titus Victor? Wait, who is Titus Victor? Oh yes, you're the guy in Mazaka. You're okay, but you're getting a bit too bloodstained for our liking. We do have Oppius Victor. I mean, oh, he's just picked up Jobsworth, which is unfortunate. But, famous orator, good commander, social drinker, gonna continue fighting the wars in Egypt, could yet be a good candidate to be faction heir over Spurius Scapula. Yeah, actually, I'm actually going to do it. I'm going to move the Factioner over to Oppius Victor, because I feel like he potentially is going to be the better leader for our Empire when it comes to it. So I'm going to set the Factioner. Lovely. So he picks up a little bit of extra skill off that. The problem is, poor Spurious Scapula, if we move over to him, he has now picked up a new trait, Disinherited. He was once the Factioner, but it was considered unsuitable. He will have to live with the dishonor, minus one influence. But he's still got decent influence. I just can't really have... Yeah, he's just not... He's not quite right. He's not quite right to actually lead the faction of an empire this large. We need someone more talented, unfortunately. So our new Parthian friends basically hold three cities around here. Then they're very close by to the Armenians. There's a good chance that Armenian army was literally marching over towards the Parthians right now. So they're probably going to run into trouble soon, which is why they wanted to make an alliance with us. But that's fine. I'm just going to leave them to hang out to dry, because to be honest, I just wanted the Armenians to be focused over there, not focused on me. So that's 100% fine. Now, as for the Egyptians, they haven't attacked us this turn. They've just moved up towards Damascus to reinforce it. And indeed, it was actually significantly weak previously. So they've kind of seen I have my eye on that. That's 100% fine. Valerius the Killer, you should be able to take out this guy, however. Yeah, 50-50 shot of taking out Kia Euergetes. Go on, and down he goes. Beautiful, well done. So we've got that faction guy out of the way. You just head back over here. We have also got, hang on, you just go like that for a second. Ah, the faction leader, 27% chance to hit. That's going to be very difficult to do. But now we've got nothing but captains around here. Much easier to take care of. Now, we've got the fleet here, and the fleet is also fully repaired. So, get this fleet up north a little bit, and get you two. Actually, have we got any, why have you got one spare? I've got one spare gap. Ah, I remember. It's because there's another onager to join. Yep, fine. So you got yourself one spare gap there. Now you've got extra onagers. Now, head down into this ship and now start your journey south. And given you can't actually get that far this turn, you may as flipping well just port overnight just to make sure you're safe. Though that does leave us a little bit short-handed, aside from the garrisons, for actually taking on any Egyptian attack. We can't really take them on in the field yet, which is unfortunate. But Mazaka is starting to train new troops up. So we'll have a new army coming in sooner or later. And of course, Greece has just gone into overdrive producing troops. So very, very soon indeed, we will have new troops coming in. Julian continuing to just throw overwhelming strength into Spain. Don't need to worry about that. The Scipio is spreading themselves a little bit thin. To be honest, I'm going to go and join up with this siege here of Tingi, because I strongly suspect that, yeah, this Scipii force here is going to struggle to break into there, so that's fine. We'll just keep an eye on that. But they've also got forces heading everywhere. They've got a couple of really small forces heading over here to Dimidi. They might be able to take over there. And Nept down here. I think they've got enough strength to just force their way into Nept, so I won't bother watching that. But I could get one unit of cavalry over here into Gaetulia. That might be worth keeping an eye on, but yeah, actually, I'll see what I can do. What have we got? In fact, actually, where'd my one unit of... Ah, there it is. Let's get that just moving in this direction. This direction. Oh, apparently you've decided to literally head over the desert. Okay, so... Oh, no, never mind. There was actually rotor. It's just I hadn't seen it yet because of the fog of war. Right, you can get there in, like, a couple of turns. So, yeah, that'll do. If you just can make it over there in, like, three turns, that should be plenty of time to join up to this siege when it happens. Marvellous. Meanwhile, they've just got most of their strength just bumming around over here. Possibly ultimately heading over here towards Cyrene, which seems to have been attacked, but possibly the Numidians couldn't take it. And then ultimately, they're heading over here towards Siwa, which looks at least moderately well defended. Okay, while it's important that I keep my southern frontier under strength, Antioch I think I could afford to empty out and actually draw up a force here to see if maybe the Egyptians are willing to take the bait, because there is a river crossing right here. If I could just hold here, if they were stupid enough to come at me there, I might be able to do a really good job weakening them there. So, Spurious Scapula, together with the... Okay, yep. Spurious Scapula, together with some basic troops, move out to here. Antioch will need to lower the tax rate. That's fine. We can do that if we need to. We've got a decent enough force here, but to be honest, the Eastern Mercenaries can just join the garrison. The rest of you guys... join up with Spurious Scapula. Anything good available? Ooh, we have got camels. No, camels are... they're all right. They're not spectacular. So, that leaves us with just three units of archers. Not a huge amount of a front line, to be honest. And no hoplites at all. What I could send in is... Ah, we do actually have Crease and Archers. And some more Archers as well. Send those guys to there. And then if you've got one more unit of good quality... Ah, Mercenary Hoplites. Spot on. Those will be good for the very front line there. And now we just need to slightly increase the level of racing. Marvelous. And get training some more troops. So I don't think any of these forces can get to us this turn, but we'll see if they start gravitating towards us. Because if they do, I think Spurious Scapula can totally hold them there. But you can see it's a bit of a scruffy army, because even though it's full stack, his banner is not quite filled up. The game knows this is not the best army, but we'll have to see what we can do here. Meanwhile, over here we've got... Ah, yes, you're the useless guy who's just going around laying the watchtowers everywhere. We do have the basic introduction of an army coming here in Mazaka, but it's slow. It's coming in very, very slowly. Over in Thrace, meanwhile, it appears the Thracians have now drawn up all their strength as well as hiring all the mercenaries they can afford for one final last stand over here. But just look at that. That population, this city's not going to grow anytime soon. That means they can't really train anything more in the way of actual, phalanxes. In fact, the fact that they're training Falxmen's interesting. That's just Falxmen's relatively early in their tech tree. So they can train Peltasts, fine. I can't see their barracks building, but I'm going to suggest that actually, you know what? Send my spy inside, and we will be able to see that, because we've got a spy right there. So, the barracks building is a meeting hall. Yes, indeed. Okay, so they can actually train Militia Hoplites and Falxmen. Fine. They can't train any advanced things, so these Phalanx Pikemen are the last Phalanx Pikemen we're ever going to see on the field, because they're never going to grow this city. They've also got themselves stables for Militia Cavalry, so no real proper cavalry either. They've got the tavern here for 5% bonus. Drink, drink, drink! Life is short, the tavern fire is warm, good attitude there. And they've also actually built some flipping sewers. They're desperately trying to kind of, you know, colonize and civilize this place, but I don't think it's going to fly. Right, the question is who wants to go over there? Because I feel like in many ways, actually, Spurious, I'd like Spurious the Ugly to lead the final charge against the Thracians, to be honest. Even, you know, I imagine basically tails of his face are used to scare Thracian children. So I wouldn't mind that happening. If that were to happen, Cornelius Brutus, like, no one needs to be in Porilissum, ultimately. Ultimately, Porilissum needs to be left unguarded, because, like, basically, well, people, the Scythians could come from this angle, but they're much more likely to come from the Campus Scythii. So therefore, we should have one commander here and one commander here. And I would like Spurious the Ugly to lead the final charge, potentially. So in which case, let's actually get you and a small group of forces just to take out whatever this is. It is literally two archers. Marvelous. Would you believe I reckon that a post-Marius general with double gold chevron experience can just about handle charging into these guys and flipping, murdering them? Yes. And the Thracians get their first reload in because, oh dear, these archers do not actually have much in the way of range. They'll get one shot in, do the thing. No, they never even got the shot in. They've just started running instead. Now everyone's running because they're all in skirmish mode. And now we just start stabbing them in the back. Beautiful. Oh, the chaos. Oh, the poor Thracians. And that unit is already flipping broken. Marvelous. Now we just need to chase you literally into the corner. They thought they were being smart, taking the high ground. They're not. Oh, I feel sorry for that guy. We just kind of dogpiled around the leader. And they go down, but let's wrap them up to make sure they don't go anywhere further. Yep, ride them all down. Ride them down. Beautiful. Yep, I saw them flee away there. Just a handful of troops have now fled inside Scythian territory. I doubt we shall ever see them again. Extremely lucky coincidence, we've actually got a tiny rebel force of just two flipping hoplites that have shown up on the road right next to Western reinforcements I was sending to the front line, or actually walking past anyway. So we may as well finish those guys off. That should be nice and simple. The advantage you've got, by the way, when you're taking on nothing but hoplites, there's literally no cavalry support whatsoever, is hoplites are so slow, you can just basically run circles around them. So if I just take up my hoplites and my Thracians right now, and I just draw them, like, here, that's absolutely fine. So we've got basically got a front line that those guys are facing right here. So just move those guys forward right there. Now we just basically encircle them with our missile troops, making sure that we do not have skirmish mode or fire at will on, because I only want them to fire when I'm ready for them to fire. In which case, you guys go over there, and you guys just start going over there. And they're not sure who they want to go for anymore, because they're so bloody slow, and I can easily outrun them under all circumstances. So they vaguely think they want to go over there towards these guys. That's fine. They're not going to close the distance, because they're on the defensive anyway. So now I'm just going to move this guy up here, I'm going to move my Cretans over here. And if they get too close to any particular troop, I'll just have that troop retreat. So this guy's now running over here, because they're desperately trying to draw themselves up kind of like between all the different troops. But they're not sure which way they want to face. So that means these guys now have... Where are you going? You know what? Screw it. I'm just going to shoot these guys in the back. I know we're going uphill, but because they're kind of like split all over the shop... Ah, they've finally decided to walk over here. That's fine. If need be, I will just simply back off. Because to be in any way combat effective, they need to actually be in phalanx. But if they're in phalanx, they're moving so slowly, I can just run away from them. Now I just stop, wait for them to figure out where they're going to turn. They turn instead towards my main line, and now I just get a shot straight in the rear. And now they'll start going down very quickly, because this is also hitting their non-shield side. So that unit of hoplites has now lost half its strength for basically no loss. They're coming up on my actual real front line. And they're eager at the minute, but that won't last, because now I'm just going to bring these mercenary peltas close by to them. I'm going to bring you, like, round more round to here. You're going to come round to here. And then they're going to realise they're surrounded, and they'll pretty much break straight away. And here we go. They're pretty much surrounded. Stop, throw your things in before they actually make touch with these hoplites. And at this point, they'll waver, and we'll just toss one thing in the back. And before the battle even begins, they will immediately break. Because of course they will. Lovely done. Right, that group is now surrounded. Everyone can now get a shot in at these guys. They're already wavering. In a moment, they'll be hit by both the arrows and that should be the end of it. No! Oh no, yes it was. Good, good. And as I was really hoping might... Oh my goodness. What the hell? So remember how Juliana's scapula was utterly, utterly terrible? Well, it turns out that little battle's been very worth our while. Good commander, natural born leader, understanding of strategy, bureaucrat, and outstanding speaker. Captain Julianus, and he's only 21. He'll be alive for decades. Oh, wow. Okay, who are you? Who are you, magnificent man? Oh, my goodness. Oh. He's unfortunately, he's got some form of genetic boldness thing going on because he's 21, but he's lost all his hair, which is a shame. But never mind, hire that unit as well. And he's just picked up a mercenary captain because of course he has. Right, this might actually just be the best man in the entire flipping empire. Well, I'm really glad we just fought that little battle because you I think could be a theoretical future emperor, damn it. Plus, I really like that story, you know, this was just some random guy who was being sent with reinforcements, but then he saw some rebels, and he stepped up to the plate, dammit, and he just took out those rebels in this crappy little province near Ancyra. People in Rome probably don't even know where that bloody is, but, you know, he did. And then he kind of, you know, he went and he joined the Egyptian campaigns, and no doubt he'll distinguish himself there. Then he'll come back to Rome gloriously. Oh, yes. I like this story. You, sir, you are marked for greatness. In fact, actually, you know what? Screw it. Obvious Brutus, unfortunately, it's been brought to my attention you are Jobsworth, which is unfortunate. And you're a social drink, and you're not a very good farmer. You know, there's just some problems here. So as a result, this new guy who's just been promoted, this is not going to go down well with the rest of the family. So as a result, Julianus Vatinius, you, sir, are going to be our new factionaire. When Amulius the Wrathful dies, oh yes. This guy's going to be amazing, damn it. You are going to be our new leader. You are going to be a fresh, exciting, young, sexy leader. Albeit a sexy, bold leader. But that's fine. Some women are into that sort of thing. That's a-okay. We need to get this man married and producing children as soon as possible, damn it. And don't forget, incidentally, to go and besiege the port at Jerusalem. The Senate wants us to do that, so if we just do that right now, that should get us something. I can't remember what. Probably some crappy unit we don't actually need and will never use. Ah, and very conveniently, the fleet that I sent north to take care of... Well, actually, take care of nothing, to be honest. Literally, their only job was just besieging this port over by the Campus Getae, because the Senate told me to. This fleet has returned just in time for this massive force, albeit very old school force. But still, solid enough. It will do a decent job, dammit, this force to be escorted over to the Egyptian campaigns to help wrap things up there. You know, I'm feeling really sorry for Oppius Victor. I think, like, within the same, like, basically the same day, he was told that he had just become the factionaire and he would become the next leader of this faction, and then it was immediately taken away from him because some new kid who's literally never done anything before over in some crappy province just fought a crappy battle in which he took out two phalanxes using Cretan archers, which probably sounds very, very easy as far as Oppius Victor is concerned, but You know what? This kid's great. We're going to get him somewhere where there's an academy. Maybe we'll let him manage Antioch, damn it. Antioch's got an academy, right? Is that an academy? No, we'll need to build it in the academy. Oh, it doesn't even have a flipping market yet. Right, okay. We need to get him somewhere where there's an academy so he can actually improve himself and get some decent retinue going on. So, nothing major from the Roman factions. Small Armenian force moving down, but nothing too big. Ooh. Larger Armenian forces heading around. Dacians and the Thracians having a chat, possibly realising at this point they don't need to go to war with each other anymore. Scythians, now. My relationship with these guys is interesting. I would like to... Ooh. What? What the... Take settlement Damascus. Well, that's absolutely 100% fine. One of the best units you can recruit. I doubt that. I think whatever you're going to give me is not going to be that good at all. Oh, they've given me 1,000 denarii. You've got to love how the Senate becomes increasingly irrelevant over time, which is perfect for the story, given we're ultimately going to end up killing them. That, you know, beginning of the game, their rewards and their gifts are so, so valuable and so, so useful. By the end of the game, completely bloody worthless. They want me to take Damascus. Well, Damascus is... Oh, there is a massive just flipping... horde of Egyptians hanging out here. Damascus has some defense, but it's not exactly spectacular. The more important thing is, yeah, there's a big army standing just outside it. If I want to take Damascus, I'm going to have to take those guys on in the open field. But I've got 10 days, so we're not exactly in a rush yet. Fine. Probably the best thing I can actually do would be instead go over here and take Palmyra, because if we take that, then that would draw some of their attention off Damascus, and then we could just swing and take Damascus a lot more easily. Ceasefire's effect between Spain and the House of the Scipi. I find that won't bloody last. More people being born. Chickpea has picked up a priest of Mercury. Lovely. Cassius the Lewd being followed on by an artist, of course he is. And Spurus the Ugly has a drill master who's probably even uglier than he is to try and take the attention off his face. Good old Spartacus the Cold-Hearted. Right, Antioch, next priority, we need to get you some roads. It's not exactly going to do... Actually, it's going to do a fairly big amount for trade. That's a nice increase in trade profit. But we really, really need those roads set up so I can actually move troops through here nice and quickly. Now, the army is going to set off as well. This force doesn't have to worry. In fact, actually, this force can just head around and start skirting out up ahead because we've got... Ah, yes. Would you believe the Egyptians have got more flipping forces coming in? But that works for me. The more forces that are flooding in this direction up towards Jerusalem to keep their cities over here safe, the less forces there are over here with Alexandria. Ooh. Okay. So it would appear the Egyptians have flipping lost Thebes. Beautiful. So they've actually lost one of their cities down here. So despite what the map says, well, they've lost Alexandria, but they hold these two cities. No, the opposite's true. Actually, they've lost this city, but they hold these two. Fine. So if I just smash into these two cities, literally the Egyptians have nothing here anymore. There's nothing left. It would be good, except the rebel city appears to have significantly more strength in it than either of the actual Egyptian cities do, even combined. So that's fun. Right, yes, we do indeed need to get this force moving down. And conveniently, as this force can only make it that far today, we may as well just harbour them there so they're nice and safe from storms, attacks, whatever. It will take still a couple of turns to make it over there, to be honest. Yes, I think, however, my plan to potentially move you, well... If I move him out to here, he could come under attack from a significant force. Potentially several significant... Oh, hello, we've actually got someone new here. We've got ourselves Ku Philometor. By the way, sorry, I should acknowledge this. The Egyptians are wrong. The Egyptians are just straight up wrong. I appreciate that, like, the game wants to do the whole, hey, the Egyptians look really different and really alien and really foreign next to all the other kind of factions. But by 235 BC, the Egyptians don't look like this. This isn't right or fair anymore. This is like a representation of a much older style of Egyptian army. The Egyptians by this point had been... They weren't exactly culturally Hellenic, but like the Greeks for centuries at this point had been sending out like colonies and traders, and there were little Greek settlements all around this area and like, you know, around the Nile and whatever. You'll find them lapsy all over the place. Like, and some of them are really well preserved, by the way, that we've got some magnificent things out of Naucratis, for example. But like, basically, the Egyptians had moved forward a little bit, and this is a representation of, yeah, it's just... I mean, like, I understand why they did it, and, like, it does make the game interesting and fun, but basically we are just kind of seeing Romans taking on, like, you know, we're seeing, like, a theoretical time-traveling empires taking on each other here. We're not really seeing what it would have been like, which is a shame. Okay, if I move my troops to here-ish, then... Actually, you know what I could do? I could... Okay, I've got an idea. I've got an idea here, which is if I move my troops to right here, onward, and then I'm going to build myself a fort.
Prepare fortification.
We have now got ourselves a fort. This is the first fort I've ever built. A fort basically is just a small micro city. It effectively works like a city. If they want to attack this thing, then they actually have to do a city siege where basically the, what is it, like 2 or 3 days or something? Wait, how do I see that? Oh, there it is. In the event of a siege, this fort can hold out for 3 days. So basically, it is a fort with a very small amount of food. You can't hold out here. I think there's like wall defenses on like the corners, but basically there's very few wall defenses. Basically, it's a way of forcing the enemy to do a city siege, and therefore you can sally for 3 days. If they want to try to attack me here, I'll be able to weaken them over a couple of days and that'll be fine. If they don't attack me here, I can head straight over to Palmyra and put that place under siege, potentially like from this side, so they'll slightly more struggle to get round to me. So yeah, because like this force around here won't quite be able to make it because they haven't invested in their own road infrastructure. Haha, I have turned their own infrastructure against them, damn it. Right, keep Julianus Vatinius moving up because he truly shall be our greatest leader. He will be magnificent when he gets going. Anyone got any troops to hand over to Julianus Vatinius? You need to say his name like that, by the way. He's not just like Julianus Vatinius. You've kind of got to say it. He is like Julianus Vatinius, that magnificent bastard. Some people have asked, by the way, I should acknowledge this, why have some of the episodes been getting shorter, next episodes earlier in this series? The reason is because you're not seeing the stuff that's happening right now, because now I've got, wait, how many towns have we got? I've got 31 regions in the Empire, which means I now have to individually manage all of them, decide what's best to keep them all growing. And as a result, that takes some time, so I just have to go around the Empire figuring out what troops need to be trained in Greece, kind of what infrastructure needs to be invested in elsewhere, make sure everything's building something, make sure the troops are all in the right place, Bylazor over here, could do with highways, say, and that mostly gets cut out. So I'm actually recording slightly longer per episode than I used to at the beginning of the series, but the episodes are a bit shorter because I'm cutting out a lot of fairly uninteresting day-to-day management of the Empire. I find it fascinating, I just don't think it would necessarily be that thrilling in terms of watching for you. And incidentally, just keep on doing that infrastructure. The one we are up here in Thrace, marvellous, we can take care of this. So, I would like Spurius the Ugly, together with, what troops do we have here at all? We don't have that many troops at Porlison, though admittedly, I need to actually send my spy out of this city to figure out what the hell the Thracian army is doing right now. Like, where did they go? What are they taking on? Are they hidden in, like, there we are, okay, we found them in the woods over here. So the Thracians are enemies with, it could have been Dacians, I suppose, but unlikely to be. It seems more likely to have just been rebels. Yeah, if I could just get some troops over there in a hurry, I might just be able to go and smash these guys. If I smash these guys here, they've lost their city. This force becomes a rebel force, in which case I can just buy it off quite nicely. Especially if this guy is, well, he's 21. I may as well buy him into the Empire if I can. There we are, Spurius the Ugly with the best troops from the Campus Getae. Don't think we need to worry about Scythia just yet. If they start building up, we can build up faster and better than them anyway. He'll start moving this way. He'll pick up some other decent troops like these good quality archers from Porolisum, which is fine. He could do with some better quality. Well, he's got the early legionary cohorts. We haven't actually seen those in action yet. So can you train those? No, you can't actually train those here. That's fine. I'll send you with some auxiliary so you've actually got a decent answer to cavalry as well. Ah, over at Carthage, meanwhile, we've got something new, which is we can build the real highest of the high infrastructure here, thanks to the Carthaginians and indeed the Numidians too for building this up. How, by the way, are you getting on? Oh, Galerius Brutus, don't be a poor trader. Dear, oh dear, don't do that in the slightest. Yes, we've got some really advanced stuff here. We've got the urban barracks where we can train the best of the flipping best here. So, of course, I've talked about the Praetorian cohort before, which is just ridiculous. But there is one level above it, which is the urban cohort, which you can see, just look at that. Melee attack 40, missile attack 18, defense 24, and it doesn't actually cost any more in upkeep than a Praetorian cohort. The urban cohorts are just ridiculous, and they also go up to excellent morale, which is good. So these guys, you know, they'll stand and fight, they'll keep running for hours, they're just absolutely flipping marvellous. Now what's going on with Tingi, by the way? Ooh, you guys are ready to go in. Maybe next turn you'll actually be ready to go in. The Julii are just bumming around. Right now they seem to be struggling to make much in the way of progress. I'm just gonna move my guy, ooh. I have to move my equities. I'd like to go and watch this siege, because this city down here, I suspect, oh yeah, this force can't take that city, or if it does, you basically have absolute confirmation the game is cheating. Whenever they try and take on this city down here, in fact, how are these cities doing? That city's basically unguarded. This city is... it's got a garrison, but it's not great. That city's... ah, you see. Right, ignore those. Whenever they go for this big city with a full stack in it, go and watch that, because surely that's got to hold them in place for at least a little while. Incidentally, just keep these troops heading in this direction, because that little force totally wants to take on Dimity, and I think they will be held there. In fact, actually, yeah, I suspect, with the exception of Nept, both these forces will be held off by the Numidians, hopefully. Though, basically, we have seen the Numidians really, really keen to lose battles, so who knows, eh? Operation laying watchtowers in the mountains is going well. By the way, we've now got watchtowers in all three of the passes, so if the Armenians do decide to attack us, we will most definitely see it coming. And we have decent garrisons and leaders waiting over here as well, so I think we should be able to hold on, even if they attack us with all their strength. They don't seem to have a huge amount of strength anyway, and hopefully it'll be distracted by the Parthians, which I think they want to take out first as a priority anyway. Right, I think that's all I can do this turn for now. Let's see how the Egyptians respond to my fort here. Because in all fairness, whatever they do, whether they ignore it or they attack it, it's kind of a win-win for me. I've set up a really good little gambit here. Ooh, okay, one force has come over here. We've been... oh, wait, hang on. What force is that? That can't be the... ah, that's the force that was going to go and help them out, but we're gonna kick those guys away. Lovely. The Numidians have been... yeah, they attempted to reinforce Nept, but they got defeated. Fine. The big force of Thracians is understandably back. That Thracian force just keeps attacking that force. Gosh darn, I think that just sunk as well. And they just flipping blockaded bastards. Right, hang on, what's that? Ah, Munis the Wrathful is dead! Oh my goodness, the untested guy just became king. Well, sorry, not king, not king. Faction leader, definitely not king and definitely not emperor, and we're definitely not going to depose the Senate and set up an autocracy. No, no, no. If you've heard that, that's wrong. Senate officers assigned. Ooh, not much. Ooh, Julianus Vatinius! He just got flipping quaestor! Oh! Oh, you magnificent bastard! He's actually got a senatorial office despite the fact that he's busy on campaign at the minute. You're only 22! Oh, I think the game, by the way, if your faction is, I think they kind of get unfair preferential treatment in terms of actually being, like, awarded senatorial officers. Because, yeah, your faction leaders tend to, like, you know, get good as a result of that. Oh, my goodness. You absolute little star. Oh, you are magnificent. Yeah, the Senate is still kind of awarding its own terrible guys that. Probably because that means there's literally no one good in the world. They don't like us anymore because we're getting too popular with the people. So we're not going to get as many officers. Though Spurius Scapula getting flipping Pontifex Maximus is nice, by the way. So he right now is a much better manager than he actually is commander. So that's good to know. But yeah, because unfortunately it would appear that the Julii and the Scipii just don't really have much in the way of competent leaders. And you can really see that, like, Marcus Julius is just not very good at all. I mean, Julianus Vatinius is already one of the best people on that board, even at a young level. He's way better than either of the Senate guys. We have become the richest faction again. Beautiful. Of course, we have got ourselves a new faction leader, Julianus Vatinius. Marvellous. And we've got, ooh, we've got a new guy come of age as well. Lentulus, ooh, Lentulus Brutus. Wait, Lentulus Brutus is, where are you again? You're in Thessalonica. Ooh, that's good. Mining engineer, there's flipping gold mines there. So as a result, yeah, you're just a little kid who's just hanging out here, aren't you? And to be honest, you're not very good. You could, over time, become a decent manager. And with a mining engineer, when there's gold... oh, yeah, mining 375 per turn. Not exactly spectacular. In fact, I should probably... as a result of that, I might want to move him over to... Sagest... I just accidentally closed that, didn't I? Right, where's the new kit? And the House of the Scipii has indeed declared war on Spain, because of course that ceasefire was never going to last. Right, I now need to find, with this thing, where that new 16-year-old kid is. And incidentally, who is the new factionaire? Oh! It's back to Spurius Scapula! Because the game is now... I don't know why that is. Like, well, probably it can't be this guy's son. He doesn't have a son right now. He's got one-year-old brother, who it probably shouldn't be. Right, Spurius Scapula, no, I don't think it should be you. In fact, in all fairness, it doesn't really matter. So actually, you know what? I'm going to award it back to, no, not Cassius the Lute. Definitely not Cassius the Lute. Oppius Victor, you can actually have it again. It's such a confusing day for Oppius Victor. He was the factionaire, then he wasn't the factionaire, then 6 months later he is the factionaire again. So you can be the factionaire. And Spurius Scapula has now actually been disinherited twice, but luckily that doesn't actually mean anything. It doesn't, like, stack or anything like that. So yeah, Oppius Brutus is now back to being factionaire, though I think at the age of 39, when the actual faction leader is a 22-year-old kid, I think he should be pretty clear he's probably not going to be faction leader at this point. It's purely an honor horrific thing. Though actually, I tell you what, we actually haven't got mines plus one at Thessalonica. That guy with the mining engineer, we can get the mining up to 656. That's a good amount to be got from mining. Now, that fleet that was damaged by the Egyptians, get that into port in Athens, get the full stack army into that fleet, but then retrain that fleet and toss an extra ship on top of that, please. Thank you. And our scouting fleet gets up ahead. We see Alexandria. The map updates to say that is indeed an Egyptian city. But yes, indeed, down here, it is still a rebel city, so that's fine. And indeed, it is basically unguarded and has a natural wonder of the world in it and everything. So we can now actually get our fleet heading down south in that direction. Probably in two turns, we're ready to begin the attack. And bear in mind, the moment we disembark, thanks to the onagers, we can attack immediately. This fleet should be strong enough to just basically head round here and just head straight on. And I don't see any sign of an Egyptian fleet. To be honest, we've taken a fair few of their ports off them already. How many ports they have left? They've got Alexandria and they've got Jerusalem. I can see there's nothing in Jerusalem. I don't think they've got much of a fleet left, especially as the fleet they did have, they sent this way and it got battered back. So that fleet's in bad shape. Interestingly, the force that's besieging Sidon is not actually that impressive, to be honest. I mean, they've got one unit Pharaoh's bowmen, but there's no general, albeit if there was, I'd just assassinate him. That's the advantage of Valerius the Killer. He's keeping things nice and simple in that regard. Couple of units of chariots, but not much. And also, it's inexperienced by the looks of things. Very inexperienced, so it doesn't gain the defensive bonuses off XP. I think, in all fairness, our army can just pretty much murder these guys. Especially as Oppius Victor deserves a chance to actually fight a good, honest battle, dammit, given he's had a confusing 6 months. Right, we've seen this style of battle before. I should be able to hit their front lines from the walls pretty easily. So in which case, let's just set up our Cretans in a good position here. Right, let's get you and indeed the new Roman cavalry, which is, as you can see there, heavy cavalry. Much, much better. So now when we take on light cavalry, it's a bit slower, but it does hit a lot harder. Effectively, the Roman cavalry is, it's not, I don't think it's quite as good as the old general's bodyguard, but it is kind of like approaching that level. So if you're kind of thinking about strength, it's about that, which is really good. Right, let's begin that. And now everyone open fire, obviously, and we'll see what these guys decided to do next. Have they decided to? Oh, it does look like they're moving forward. They're doing the stupid Egyptian thing again. That's good. Right forward into the walls. That's right. Well done, you stupid bastards. Except, oh dear, these heavy axemen are not doing well, quite frankly. It would appear that, yes, they are being torn to shreds very quickly. Right, let's get our cavalry out of here. This time, I'm not going to let these guys get away. These guys are being flipping, taken down to the last man. Did you have any actual... I swear you had, like, some Pharaoh's bowmen. I mean, there's some basic bowmen. There's some Pharaoh's bowmen. Right, let's just let this line move up towards us quickly, because these two units are just going to be destroyed, as did these chariots. Then if the line moves up after that, I should have a good opportunity to hit these Pharaoh's bowmen with my cavalry. Here we go. This is the moment we're waiting for. These desert guys are going to go down straight away. As soon as they're all dead, the rest of the line will start moving to fill the gap that it thinks exists there. And as a result of them moving, we'll be able to shoot these guys in the side. They're running over to that side, so their shields are on their left. I'm shooting them in the right. By the way, thank you to the people who were pointing out, yes, indeed, when I was doing my bridge battles, I positioned my archers on the wrong side. They should have been on the other side of the bridge, so I was shooting the non-shield arm. Very good spot. My mistake. Next time I do a bridge battle, I will fix that. And I think I just heard the cry to retreat. They've decided they don't want to do this anymore. Let's get after them. Oppius Victor, together with some new cavalry. Get after them. Marvelous. Ride them down if we can. This unit didn't get the memo that we're retreating. That unit just did not get the memo in the slightest. Right, guys, get after them, get after them. We should be able to get after at least a few of them, damn it. Actually, what I'd really like to do is I'd like to hit the bowmen, but I suspect they're going to get out of the town before I can get to them. Sadly, the disadvantage of a sally is the enemy are relatively close by too. Oh, come on, guys. Just gently tap them in the back. Oppius Victor, what the hell are you doing? You're supposed to be pursuing, damn it. Yeah, I think we should be able to. If we can just, like, hit them and make them stop retreating for a second, we should just be able to surround them and get them in a set. No! No, because my cavalry decided to show mercy on this occasion. I didn't order them to, but whatever. And they've just retreated to Jerusalem to retrain up. So actually, they'll be back up to strength in no time at all, irritatingly. Fine, in that case, time for, yes, this force of... Oh, Spurious Scapula, who has indeed gone a little bit on the... he's a bit on the grey side these days, unfortunately. It's time to move him forward. Let's see if we can get him to attack Palmyra. Because if he can just hold there, then this force, well, this force could indeed go up and try and relieve him, but, ooh, this is a risk. A big enough Egyptian force could very, very easily take out Spurus Scapulae, but even if I did take a loss there, it would move all those troops over, so as a result, I could get, ooh, could I get a force round two? I could probably get a force round straight away to, could this force get over there? If I didn't, then Julianus Vatinius, oh, he could. This could be his first great victory, seizing Damascus from under the noses of the flipping Egyptians. Oh, yes. Yes, I like that idea. Right, you, move forward. Right now, you've just got an army of flipping mercenaries, but it's fine. Incidentally, you, finish off your job laying up some more watchtowers here. Round here, one more watchtower. Beautiful. Well done. Now just back away. Thank you. Now we've got really good visibility of all of the flipping Armenian holdings here. Beautiful. You can also pick up some Arab cavalry, which is basically very fast moving. It's not very good in a fight, but it is useful for pursuit. So, let's also send any of the decent troops. I'm going to say the decent troops. We've not got much here. We'll have to just make do with some old Principes, some old Equites. Yeah, this is a little bit on the light, fluffy side here. Incidentally, we have got actually Pyricides! You've been in this faction for a long time. I didn't learn your name yet because you haven't actually done anything. That's fine. All we need to do now is actually, we need some more troops here. Right, can you send just some reinforcing flipping guys? There we are, that'll do. And I'm training some peasants over here at Tarsus to send over to Salamis so we can get this place up to a large town sooner rather than later, which will be very good indeed. We've got some reinforcements coming from Mazaka, but they're coming in slowly, damn it. This force of, yeah, this is not a great force. It's not a great force at all. Actually, you know what? Screw it. Buy the mercenary Peltas. By literally everyone, the Eastern mercenaries can just go back to Antioch to help reinforce the garrison there. Marvellous, that keeps that place happy. Right, Julianus Vatinius is ready to make his move, theoretically, and Spurius Scapula is, I wouldn't exactly say he's a sacrifice, but I would say this is potentially not going to end well for him. The question is, where do we want to put him? So if I put him around the far side of the city, there's a good chance plenty of these guys won't be able to get to him. This main force, ooh. Actually, that's a really good point. If I just sent one unit around here... Oh, have we got an actual... Oh, we've actually got a lead around here. Hang on. Oh, an obvious victor just picked up a military tribune. Oh, that's good. I missed that entirely. Yeah, we've got one leader right here. I'd like him out of the way, please, just in case he's got, like, a boost movement trait or anything like that. 50-50 shot to take out you. And sadly, we've missed. Oh, well, that's a shame. Valerius the killer, you are still a very, very good killer. But even your kind of comedy retinue of a pet monkey, a catamite, and a skilled courtesan who all walk into a bar, sadly, could not actually take him out. It was still a 50-50 shot. He must be a bit paranoid. Unfortunately, if you try and assassinate someone and fail, they often become a bit more paranoid and conscious of security because someone just tried to assassinate them. They are aware it failed. So as a result, it can be harder to assassinate them next time, which is a shame. But I don't really believe in, like, kind of, you know, like, saving and doing assassinations over and over and over. If I fail one, I will just accept it. Ah, very irritatingly, that massive city full of a full stack army, I thought, well, they'll never take that. They seem to have, I don't know, the army is either cleared out, or possibly the Julii were just awarded a basically impossible victory. Either case, very, very annoying indeed. Right, time to make our choice with Spurus Scapula here. We have got a couple of armies ready to move against Damascus, but we need the bait. Now, if I go the near side of the city, then these armies could attack me directly. If I go the far side, I think that's got to be safer. It's got to be safer to be attacking from this corner, because then, if the heat's too bad, I can just retreat back to this fort. And actually, what I could do is I could keep one unit in this fort to make sure it doesn't dissolve, because forts disappear off the battle map if there's nothing in them for, I think it's just like one full turn. So if I just leave one unit in here to guard the fort, then as a result of that, that would actually, you know what I could do? Ooh. Okay, this is interesting. Okay, I could abandon the fort, but I could also put a new fort up to try and guard Palmyra from any form of advance. Just like a temporary stalling tactic. Yeah, actually. Okay, that could work. So what I need to do here is select everyone, leave one archer behind. Now, they're coming from this direction. So if I put a fort about here-ish, move my troops down here, and now build myself a new fort. Wait, hang on. No, that wasn't what I meant to do. Sorry. The guy's supposed to be hanging out in this fort. Wait, sorry, my mistake. So now, everyone's going to clear out of this fort, and actually, let's just double check here. Everyone is now going to... They can't make it to Palmyra anymore. The big force cannot make it to Palmyra. Yes, okay. Now what we're going to do is everyone's going to go around to the top if they can. Actually, will the top be... That'd be fine. If a small force makes it over to Palmyra, that's actually fine. So I'm going to go over to here, and then I'm going to besiege the city from here. Maintain that siege for a moment. Take that archer and move them down here. And this fort now will actually hold out for 0 turns and will actually probably disintegrate. So he's now going to be there. I'm now just going to build a whole bunch of an unnecessarily large number of rams, and we can go into Palmyra. Now, they might be able to get some troops round to me next turn, like this force right here, for example, might be able to relieve the city, but if so, that'll just be sacrificed. There's nothing in this city but just a handful of troops, and I assume these guys are damaged based on how full up the banner is. But that fort should have just blocked them from getting to me. So now we just need to wait and see what the Egyptians are going to do next and how they're going to try and respond to this. And incidentally, I am so, so sorry, Roman archer unit, but at this point you are pretty much just sacrificed. So, ladies and gentlemen, next time we will see how the Egyptians decide to deal with this attack on Palmyra, whether they actually decide to try and relieve the city. If they do, what happens to that poor archer unit, and whether Julianus Vatinius gets his first actual victory seizing Damascus. Meanwhile, we have also got a Scipiae army to watch. I suspect that they will lose unless the Numidians continue their track record of losing very, very badly indeed. But if I can just get over here in time, I suspect the Julii might just struggle with this fight as well. We shall see. All of that is to come very, very soon, ladies and gentlemen. But in the meantime, I've been John. This has been many a true nerd, and this has been Rome Total War. Thank you very much, and goodbye. We're going to build a large green park as a memorial to the bloody place that wouldn't stop burning down. Oh gosh darn it, the building next door is just catching fire instead. Can I just kind of demolish a church or something to make room for it? Because I will. Then next to the magnificent city hall, a giant statue of me.